Now that I found water deep enough to dive, I can't go back to the shore. Next to you, God, everything's for gold. The water in the desert, 'cause every time it's leaving me dry. I walk the world looking for something better.
Thank you. Be seated. Well, good morning. It's good to see all of you this morning. We're so glad you're here to worship with us on this fall Sunday. It's fall, y'all. We actually got some good weather. That's right. Hey, if you are a guest, we want to say a special welcome to you this morning. Thank you so much for being here today with us as we worship the Lord Jesus Christ. Hey, here's the deal. If you are a guest today and this is your first time, we wanted you to know that we have a worship guide that we hand out when folks walk in. So if we missed you and you'd like to have one of those to see what's going on, in just a minute, we're going to greet each other around, the folks that are around you, and you can grab one. It's right over here to my right, your left, these double doors. There'll be a table that has one. But there's inside of that is a little slip that says first guest. And we'd love to have some information about your visit so that we can contact you, see how it went. And so if you'd like to give us some of that, just give us what you would prefer us to contact you by. So if it's an email, phone number, whichever way, that'd be great. And someone from the group staff will reach out to you this week. Also, if you'd rather do it on your phone, you can go to thewoodlandsfirst.org. Right there on the front page, there's an I'm New tab. Click that, has a similar form, and just give us the information you're comfortable with, and we'll reach out to you this week. If you'd like to talk to somebody today, whether it's your first time or you've been visiting for a while, to my right, your left, as you leave, is our Connection Center. There'll be some folks in there would love to visit with you. If you have a ministry need, we'd love to visit with you about that. Or if you just want information about the new members class or anything that's going on at the church, again, we can give you all the information you need there in the Connection Center to my right, your left, as you leave the services today. All right, we have a couple things that we want to announce. The first thing is we have a pumpkin patch that we're going to start at our North Campus, and it begins a week from today, the 15th of October. If you'd like to volunteer to be a part of that, it's going to be a great deal. There's shifts you can sign up for. The information is right there in your bulletin. It's a great thing for the community to come and see our North Campus, to know about our church on either campus. And so we need your help serving and being a part of that. You can serve as a family. It'll be a lot of fun. My family signed up, and we're excited about being a part of that. And then the second thing that you want to know about today is on October the 29th is our fall trunk or treat. Waiting. Okay, there we go. No, it's a fun deal, and we had a blast last year. Tons of candy got passed out. A bunch of people came on our campus. We got to meet folks, and it's just fun seeing all the kids. And so if you'd help us be a part of that this year by signing up to be a trunk, folks from our group staff is going to be contacting kids folks and student folks and adults and first gen. So you may already be getting those emails. But sign up, decorate a trunk, and then also you can donate candy, which helps. And you can do that through, there's some links that are listed right there in your worship guide that help you get stuff through Amazon or however you want to donate candy and be a part of that. But it's going to be a big deal. We'll get to reach a lot of folks on that day. Okay, Daniel, I believe you have one other announcement before we finish.
I do. Let's go ahead and stand together. But before we turn around and greet each other, we have a challenge for you. Are you ready? One person is ready. Are you ready? Think you can do it? Good. You have no idea what you just volunteered for. All right, well, this morning we need a choir, and you are it. Are you ready? So, if you have ever wanted to sing before on stage, this is your chance. Yes, you. Some of you are like, I will never, ever do that. You are crazy. And some of you are like, I have been waiting for this all of my life. So if that's you this morning, you are invited to join the choir. You can head this way right now. And the rest of you who that is not your love language, go ahead and turn around, find somebody next to you, say hello, get their name, tell them you're glad to see them this morning.
As we get ready for our choir this morning, let's go ahead and read our Bible verse from today. Our Bible verse from today is in Acts 1, 6-11. Then they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the dates or times the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? The same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. Let's pray. God, we're grateful for you. We're grateful for your word and the truth that's in there for us to learn from, be inspired by. God, we're so grateful that we get to be here to worship you today through song and through fellowship. Be with us for the rest of this morning. And open our ears and our eyes to exactly what you want us to learn today. Amen.
Romans 8:22-28. It says, we know that the whole creation has been groaning as in the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption to sonship, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved, but hope that is seen is no hope at all. Who hopes for what they already have? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait for it patiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit Himself intercedes for us through wordless groans. And He who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for God's people in accordance with the will of God. And we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love Him, who have been called according to His purpose.
Fire of God, fall within. Holy Ghost, breathe on us.
Praise your name. It's one family, one congregation this morning. And we pray that we would continue our worship with you, of you, as we open your word this morning. Help us to understand more of who you are, more of your plan and your will for our lives. Thank you for our time together. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
All right, let's give them a hand. Thank them for helping us to lead this morning. Thanking for every extrovert, their dream just came true this morning. And for all their all the introverts, their nightmare, you know, would be to be up there. But you guys did a great job. Open your copy of God's Word, please, to Acts chapter 1, verses 6 through 11. We're in a series that I've been calling Foundations, where we're talking about 10 passages of Scripture which I believe are foundational to our understanding of what it means to walk with Christ, to be a disciple of Jesus Christ. This is kind of my top 10 New Testament list. If we don't get these passages, we're going to have a real hard time understanding what it means to really follow Jesus. And I think when we come to that list, we need to include Acts chapter 1. Today, there are 2.5 billion people on earth who identify as Christians. That's a pretty amazing thing to think about when you realize that when this all began, there were 120 disciples, men and women, who were in the upper room, kind of hiding out in Jerusalem. It's a good reminder that a few people who are committed to Christ can have a tremendous influence, and that big things start small. Why did this little cult? Because that's the way they were viewed by the people in that day, and certainly the religious leaders at the time. Why did this little cult not waste away and wilt under opposition when their leader was crucified, as most groups like that did? What caused the explosive growth that went from all over Jerusalem and Judea and throughout the entire Roman Empire? And then when the Roman Empire ceased to be the kingdom of God on earth through his church, continued to expand literally all around the world. The first part of the answer is the resurrection of Jesus, that Jesus was simply who he said he was. And that incredible, awesome message just spread. Good news travels. Now, the second part of the answer is that the spirit of the resurrected Jesus began to live inside those believers. And the promise of God in Scripture is that the same power that raised Christ from the dead is now living in you and me and in his people. And that powerful truth is something that we're going to talk about all next week in our time together. And there's no way to overemphasize the importance of God's spirit in his people. This morning, however, I want to focus in on another reason. And that is, those early followers of Jesus did not allow themselves to be distracted from their primary calling to be God's witnesses to the world. But they, as we are, were tempted. In verse 6 of our text, the disciples gathered around Jesus and said, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" Now, the Old Testament prophets, which that was their Bible, the Old Testament prophets looked with anticipation toward that day when the promised and prophesied Messiah would come. The enemies of God would be absolutely destroyed, the faithful would be rewarded, and the kingdom of God established. It wasn't a bad question for the disciples to ask, or something bad for them to desire. In fact, I join with them. I think most of us join and look forward to that time. And this particular verse, it seems particularly relevant in light of the horrendous attack upon civilians in Israel yesterday. Not soldiers, but civilians. 600 that I saw in the last report that I looked at, grandmothers and women and children, and I mean, just civilians living out their lives. The disciples in Jerusalem longed for the day when Isaiah's prophecy in Isaiah 11 would be fulfilled, when he wrote, "The wolf will live with the lamb, and the leopard will lie down with the goat. The calf and the lion and the yearling together, and a little child will lead them. The cow will feed with the bear, their young will lie down together, and the lion will eat straw like the ox. The infant will play near the cobra's den, and the young child will put its hand into the viper's nest. And they will neither harm nor destroy on all my holy mountain, for the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea." They longed for that day. I do too. Would you pray with me as we pray for that today? Our Father, we come before you today praying for Israel and for the nation of Israel and for all of the Middle East. Indeed, Lord, we pray for our whole world. And we pray for those who are hurting right now, who are struggling, who have been struck by sin and evil, and we pray for your comfort. We pray for your Holy Spirit to touch Israel and the Middle East in their lives, and God, somehow we pray that you'll bring your will, your good, pleasing, and perfect will through all of this. God, we look forward to the day. We thank you for the promise and the assurance that it's not always going to be like this. God, sometimes we don't even know what to pray or how to pray it, but we just pray for your help now. We pray that you'll help us be what we need to be in the middle of it. We pray that you'll give your spirit to those today who need it, and I pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. When the resurrected Jesus stood before the disciples in Acts 1, 2,000 years ago, the people of Israel were under the brutal occupation of the Roman Empire. Their political leaders were corrupt and unjust beyond anything that we can even imagine, which is really saying something. And there was no peace. It is little wonder they asked the risen, conquering Jesus in verse 6, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore your kingdom to Israel?" And Jesus said to them and to us, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority." And from the beginning of Christianity, people like you and me have always been susceptible to being distracted by eschatology, and that's the study of end times. We're tempted to spend too much energy on times and dates like little children on long trips who just won't stop asking, "When are we going to get there?" How many times have you heard about some individual or group? They've figured out when Jesus is going to come and the world will end, and they are happy to sell you a book about when it will happen. And inevitably, people like you and me, who ought to know better, start getting distracted, and we stop reflecting, and we stop obeying God in the present. Jesus said it's not for you to know the times or the dates the Father has set by his own authority. That seems really clear to me. And earlier in the Gospel of Matthew 24, verse 36, Jesus said, "About that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, nor the Son, but only the Father." If Jesus doesn't know, we're sure not going to. Instead of spending our time trying to figure out exactly when, we should live our lives now with an understanding that Jesus could return at any moment. And I will tell you this, if Jesus returned right now, he wouldn't have to explain himself. He certainly wouldn't have to apologize. Everything has been fulfilled. I mean, we could certainly be that time. Listen to what Jesus said just after he said, "No one knows the day or hour." He continues in Matthew 24, 37 through 44, "As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking and marrying and giving in marriage up to the day Noah entered the ark," right up until the day. "And they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That's how it's going to be at the coming of the Son of Man. Two men will be in the field, and one will be taken and the other will be left. Two women will be grinding with a handmill. One will be taken and the other will be left. Therefore, keep watch, because you do not know on what day your Lord will come. But understand this, if the owner of the house had known at what time of night the thief was coming, he would have kept watch and would have not left his house or let it be broken into. So here's the point. You also must be ready, because the Son of Man will come at an hour when you do not expect him." Jesus is coming again. It is imminent, not necessarily immediate. But I'll tell you this, in all that's going on in our world, if I didn't know Christ, I wouldn't wait one more second. I wouldn't wait a second. I would give my life to Christ right now, because it could be any moment. But here's the deal. If you're a follower of Christ, if you know Jesus, you don't have anything to worry about. You have nothing to worry about. I mean, it should be something we should be at peace with. We can look forward to the coming of Christ, because it means the establishment of God's peace on earth. So we don't need to fear. God doesn't want us fearing. And frankly, our anxiety sometimes during these times doesn't reflect well on who we say we are and what we say we believe. So until then, the message of the text in the second half of verse 8 is, "You are to be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all of Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." In Matthew 28, the Great Commission, we talked about that last week, I know, but I was gone, so I can't completely leave it out. Jesus said, "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you, and I will be with you to the very end of the age." Did you notice in the text last week, did you notice it said all nations? All nations. That's significant because the Jews 2,000 years ago, during the time of Jesus, they felt as God's chosen people, they didn't need to be concerned about other nations and people of other nations. Remember the book of Jonah? The Jonah was about the prophet. God told, go to Nineveh and tell them the message of God. And Jonah's like, nope, I'm not going, because he didn't want them to be saved. Now, that was kind of the attitude. We even see the attitude in Acts 1:6 in the question, Lord, are you going to restore at this time the kingdom to Israel? But God's saying, I'm concerned not just about Israel. He's very concerned about Israel. God's concerned about the whole world. And the fact that God was concerned not just about Israel didn't make him less concerned or less in love with Jesus. You know how it was? I had my first child, and all of my love went into that first child. And Nancy's too. And then we had another child. And you know what happened? All of our love went into our first child and our second child. And you know what? There was no lack of love for the first child because we had the second child. And then we had the third child. And there was plenty of love to go around. And that's what God is saying here. It wasn't an insult to Israel. God is concerned about the whole world. That's why he says, go and make disciples of all nations. Acts 1's the sequel to the Great Commission, and Jesus tells his disciples and us, they were to be his witnesses everywhere. In Jerusalem, you bet. That referred to where the Jews were. It refers to where we are. As Jesus' witnesses, we should start right where we are. Judea refers to the area around Jerusalem. That would be our Texas. Now, Samaria, though, that was different. Samaria was only about 35 miles away from Jerusalem, but it was far, far away culturally and racially. I mean, it was miles and miles away there. And to the Jews at the time, they were God's chosen people, and so they believed God loved them, but were very sure that God did not love Samaria. God had a different message. Who speaks a different language than we do? Who votes differently than we do? Who thinks differently than we do? Who looks different than we do? Who comes from a different place or culture? Jesus says that we're to be his witnesses of God's grace and salvation to those people. And to the ends of the earth explains itself. We're to be Jesus' witnesses to all places and to all people. Now, in every church I've ever been in, and I've only been in senior pastor, this is my third and hopefully last church, I've only been in great churches, but in every church I've ever served, I've had people who say, why do we need to do mission work and share Jesus outside of our community when there's plenty for us to do right here where we are? Well, there's not a doubt about that. But I want to point out that Jesus doesn't say that we're to be his witnesses in Jerusalem, and then when we get all of that taken care of, then we're to go to our Judea, and then when we get all of that done, then we can go to Samaria, which in reality means we would never get to Samaria. But Jesus doesn't say that. We're then to go to Samaria, and then when we get all of that taken care of, we're to go to the ends of the earth. Jesus doesn't say we're to be his witnesses in Jerusalem or Judea or Samaria or to the ends of the earth. What Jesus says is we're to be his witnesses in Jerusalem, in Judea, and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. So the reason we share Jesus with other places, even though we haven't completed the task where we are, is because Jesus commands it. It isn't a choice. And sometimes as the Holy Spirit says to me, I won't say it that way to you, but as the Holy Spirit says to me sometimes, Webb, I'm not asking you. This is not This is not a question. This is not based on your opinion. This is what I'm saying as God. That's what God is saying in this text. You don't get a choice. It's not an either or. It is a both and, because God wants all people everywhere to be saved and to know His love and peace. Now the Jews 2,000 years ago, they had falsely come to believe that being God's chosen people meant that God only cared about them. What's clear when you read the Old Testament is that God chose them by grace, not because they deserved it. Read Deuteronomy chapter 7 and chapter 9 for your homework assignment, where God very clearly says on numerous times, He says, I didn't choose you because you were more numerous or more power than other people. I didn't choose you because you were more righteous than anybody else. But God chose the Jews, this insignificant people at the time, not because they deserved it, but He chose them by His grace so that when the rest of the world looked and saw how God had blessed this insignificant people, the rest of the world would say, I want to know that God. This people, chosen by God's grace, was to be witnesses to all the world of the one true God. Instead, they closed in on themselves. As followers of Jesus, you and I, we're chosen for the same reason. We have been saved for the same reason, not because we deserve it, not because we've done anything that's different from anybody else, but we've simply accepted God's grace, and God has chosen to use us as His missionary strategy to reach the whole world. We are to be His witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. You know what that means? Well, it obviously means the people in Jerusalem and Judea, but even the people in Samaria and the people of the ends of the earth, they're not our enemies. They're our mission field. I mean, if we see them as our enemies, we're never going to reach them. We're never even going to try. We're going to try and kill them. They're not our enemies. They're our mission field. Hatred dehumanizes people and leads to the kind of horrific tragedy that we're witnessing in Israel right now. It is sickening, and it is horrible to watch. Because folks in their hatred and their sense of being wronged, they feel they've been wronged, and in their hatred, they see not people. They see demons, and they can do anything that they want, and they're doing it. And the love of Jesus is the only cure. Ooh, that sounds naive, doesn't it? That doesn't mean we can't protect ourselves. Doesn't mean you can't protect your family. But I'm telling you that violence leads to more violence. Hatred leads to more hatred. And Jesus, the one we say we serve, in a very difficult way for us sometimes to grasp, saying, I've got a different way. It's not a simple way. Jesus says, love your enemy. Man, how do you do that? I don't know how to do all of it. But I know that hatred leads to hatred. And violence leads to more violence. And Jesus said, the problem with the eye for eye and tooth for tooth is that pretty soon we're all blind and needing dentures, right? That's where that goes. And the love of Jesus is the only cure. And Jesus tells His disciples to go to the ends of the earth with the good news of Jesus, because God loves all people so much. He died for them, and He calls us to be His witnesses of grace to them. Our staff has been reading a book this semester, and we've been discussing it. And there was something in our reading that I just thought was so good. It wasn't because it was new. It's not something you don't know, but it's just something we all need to be reminded of over and over again. And it said, in the book, it said, the purpose of the church is not to serve one another, as is often said. But the primary purpose of the church is to serve God. Now, obviously, when we serve God, he tells us to serve one another. The problem is when serving one another takes the precedence and it becomes God, we can forget our calling to reach those outside of our group with the good news of Jesus. And when our primary purpose is to serve God, we tell others about Christ outside the church and we serve God inside it and serve one another inside it. It's never one without the other because both are God's command and his will. It's the reason we have two campuses. Wasn't because I thought, wouldn't it be fun to have two campuses, have more to think about? That's not why. It's the reason some of the people in this church have gone there. It's not just because it'd be a fun thing to do, but because it's our calling to reach the world. It's why we have a community missions food pantry. Well, it's not because we didn't have enough to eat or you don't have enough food. Jim Blair is the one whose passion really kind of got that started. Jim had plenty of food. You know, that was not his problem. Plenty of resources. Because it was God's calling to reach people who didn't. It's why we have a service in Spanish. Most of you don't even speak Spanish. But there are a lot of people who do and need Christ. It's why we do English as a second language and MOPS. Mothers of Preschoolers. It's why we're helping hundreds of churches in Mexico do VBS. It's why we'll be in England and Germany and Brazil and Argentina and Tanzania. It's why we're involved in Ethiopia with some from our church. I believe Don is there right now, providing clean drinking water and the living water of Jesus. It's why we do this packing of the Operation Christmas Child boxes. So a little child, some of them from a Muslim country, will sit there and open up a box and receive a testimony of someone in the United States who's maybe been told all their lives that didn't care anything about them, but will hear about the love of Jesus that way. It's why I preached at a partnership church in Maine last Sunday, where there's a group of believers there where only 3% of the population are evangelical in Maine. And not a lot of people go to church. And Ed Savage and Judy Savage and Bryce and Fonda Whitaker went 2 weeks or so before me and helped put in a sound system that we all helped to pay for and that Ed gave some individual money toward that. It's the reason that Brian and Mona Butler and Juan and Micheline and Paul Davis were in Egypt just this last week. There's a video there, I think, that you can see. And, you know, sometimes you feel a little uncomfortable or look a little strange being as witnesses in other countries. It's enough of that. You can take it off the screen, but that sometimes is a little bit what it looks like to put yourself out there. But it's why we give to our association of churches in our area and why we give to the Texas Baptist Cooperative Program to help college students through the BSM come to know and follow Jesus. And we give to help start churches in Texas. We got plenty to do right here. Every time we do budget cycle, there's this temptation to say, let's keep it all here. We got plenty to do. But the reality is we're called by Jesus to be his witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. And that's your calling too, individually. You say, well, how in the world can I do that? I can't be two places at one time. And boy, don't I know it. Because I feel it every time I'm gone from here to be at the North Campus. I wish I could be in both places. We can't be two places at one time. But you know what we can do? We can pray. We can encourage. We can be cheerleaders. We can give. We can help some other people. You know, it may be there's a foreign country. Maybe you can't go to Egypt. Wouldn't be a smart thing for you to do, but you might be able to support somebody else to go through our GoFund. Maybe you can't go to Germany or England on one of our mission trips or do this, but you can help support it. And that's part of what God is calling us to do. If we want our society to be better and we want people to be transformed, and I know we do, the only way for that to happen is to be Jesus' witnesses in the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, years ago, John Bassanio, he's gone on to be with the Lord, but John used to say, the main thing is to make sure the main thing stays the main thing. And the main thing is that people come to know Christ as Lord. That's the view from the inside of the church. That's God's message to us inside the church. But I want you to think for just a minute about Acts 1, verse 8, in Matthew 28, the Great Commission, what it means to those who are outside the church. I was thinking about that this week. I got sick, so I'm not going to shake your hand or hug your neck. I'd like to do that too, but I'm not going to today. So I'm not being unfriendly. It's just I don't want to get blamed when you get sick for it. But I was thinking about those who are outside of the church. What must this sound like to them? You know, those of us inside the church, we're to go and be his witnesses and to all nations, Jesus said. And Jesus said in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and even to the ends of the earth. And when, as God's people, when we're doing that, we're reflecting God's grace and God's pursuing love. But I wonder what it feels like to hear this if you're outside the kingdom. If you are outside the kingdom of God looking in right now, man, what I hope is that you are flattered. I hope you're flattered beyond belief. Because God's command to his people is a compliment to you. God is saying you matter to him. God is saying through this text, he loves you so much that he died so that whosoever would call upon his name would be saved. And whosoever is a category big enough for you, no matter who you are or what you've been. God chose you to follow him before you ever even thought about making a move toward him. I just hope you're stinking flattered right now that this everything we've been talking about today as God's church is about you. Francis Thompson was born in 1859. He felt called to be a priest as a young man, and he began training at a Catholic school. After a time, he dropped out, and he entered a medical school, and then he dropped out of medical school, too, and he went to London. He was poor. He was in bad health. He was broke. He was addicted to opium. He was, by the standards of this world, a complete and a total loser. Although he had all this potential, had completely wrecked it, and the world had given up on him. And yet, throughout all of his failures, God didn't give up on him. Isn't that amazing? The Almighty, Holy God didn't. God, instead of standing there and saying, "All right, get your act together and you come here and beg me, and maybe, then I'll receive you." Instead, the Almighty, Holy God of the universe relentlessly pursued him. Thompson wrote about it in a very famous poem entitled "The Hound of Heaven." I fled him down the nights and down the days. I fled him down the arches of the years. I fled him down the labyrinthine ways of my own mind. And in the midst of tears, I hid from him and under running laughter. And Francis Thompson pictured God like a bloodhound that was sniffing him out, always in the distance, occasionally letting out a howl just to remind him that he was on his trail. He wrote that he fled across the margins of the world, but the refrain always came back, still with unhurrying chase and unperturbed pace, deliberate speed, majestic instancy, come on the following feet and a voice above their beat. At first, it seems offensive to compare God with a hound, doesn't it? And truthfully, God's majesty, of course, is beyond any appropriate description. But who can deny the Lord's character? Which initiates and searches out the one who is lost. It's just all throughout the New Testament. It's the theme. The woman who's searching out the lost coin. The shepherd searching out the lost sheep. It's all throughout the scriptures because it's reflecting who God is. Jesus said to his people, "Go and make disciples of all nations. You're to be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria, even to the ends of the earth. And when God's people resist, God lights a fire under them and makes them go. But look at the God who's doing this. The pursuing God behind it all. And if you're on the outside of the kingdom of God looking in, it might feel a little odd to be the target of those stumbling, bumbling followers of Jesus. And that's sometimes what we are, I have to admit. I mean, I go to the Aggie game sometimes, and there's this guy standing there yelling at everybody through the megaphone, and I'm just like going, you're not helping. You're hurting. And I watch these people hold up signs sometimes, and I'm thinking, this is just not a very good way to do it. And I think of some of the stumbling, bumbling ways I've tried to communicate the will of God behind all of that. Behind it all, can you see what's really behind it? It's imperfect people trying to execute it, but it's the God of the universe who is pursuing you. That's grace. And I'm going to pray in just a moment that you experience the same blessed surrender and peace that Francis Thompson did, and that I certainly did, and every one of you who have given your life to Christ have certainly felt God's grace pursuing you. For those of us on the inside looking out, you know, what if we realized that God hasn't blessed us just so that we can live in a nice house, or houses, or drive a nice car, or go on nice vacations, and build up big retirement accounts? What if it ever dawned on us, really, that God didn't just bless us so that we could be happy, but so that the world could know Christ? And we started using our wealth to make that happen. What if we realized God was blessing us so that we could be a blessing and share Jesus with our Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth? In verses 9 through 11 of our passage, it says that he, Jesus, was taken up right before their eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight, and they were intently looking up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, the two men said, why are you standing there looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven, he'll come back in the same way that you have seen him go into heaven. He'll straighten it all out. But why are you just standing there? In other words, get with it. Stop just standing there. Get with it. And share the light of Christ with the world that so desperately needs to hear it. Would you pray with me? Father, we thank you today for your word, for the challenge that it is to us. Lord, we pray that we would really be your people authentically, that you would use us, Lord, to reach our Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. God, I pray if there's somebody who's here this morning, they've been watching all this go on, and they feel in some way they've been kind of the subject of it because they've been on the outside watching, looking in. Lord, I pray that they just see behind it all is you pursuing, in your love and grace, pursuing them. And God, I pray that you'd give them the good sense, Lord, to stop running, to turn and to follow you, that they would surrender their lives to you today. And I pray for the same thing for all of us who are your people, that we'd stop running from your calling on our life and we'd say yes to it and begin to answer your calling. Lord, I know your Holy Spirit's been present. You've been saying some things that I haven't said, and I know that you've said them better than I've said them. And I pray you'd give us the courage to obey and do what you told us to do. And Lord, as we give back now a portion of all that you've given us, we do so with a great sense of gratitude and joy, praising that you'll use it so that people can come to know you. And once again, Lord, we lift up our world to you. We know their need is your love. And we pray that your Holy Spirit would do some things we can't make happen, but we're certainly willing to be used as you guide us. And we pray this in the name of the risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And God's people said together, amen. Let's stand as we worship together.
church. And